Hello, hello. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Awesome, awesome. How's everyone doing tonight?
Good.
That's great. Ooh, there we go. Oh, almost. No. Well, what's up, guys? For those of you that may not know me, my name is Daniel. I'm one of the leaders here. And guys, I'm super pumped to be here tonight and to be able to bring the word with you or for you guys. I'm actually pretty upset that I missed last week. I heard that it was really good. Can everyone give a round of applause to Mr. Paco that brought the word? Yes. Yes. So I was super bummed about that because I love coming to Vox, but also I had a pretty good reason to not be here. So one of my sisters, she just had a baby gender reveal. Everyone say, aww. Right. So I found out that I'm going to be the uncle to a baby boy, and we're pretty pumped about that. Yes. So I'm pretty excited about that. Reason being is, like, I really just enjoy, like, hanging out. Like, little kids to me are, like, hilarious. Anyone else? Anyone else, like, just likes? But, like, okay, the rest of you guys are heartless then. Like only, like, three people, right? So, like, little kids are hilarious to me. Every Sunday morning, I help out at Kid Life. And I see a couple Kid Life leaders here, too. Shout out to Kid Life. And, bro, they are hilarious. Like, you'll be hanging out with a second grader, and they'll just be coloring in, like, a flower. And then the very next second, they'll be like, teacher. I'm like, what? And he's like, what's the meaning of life? I'm like, bro, like, what? Like, hold on a second. Like, what's going on here? You're supposed to be, like, playing with Plato, not be Plato, okay? Like, where's with this philosophy over here? Like, you guys are too ahead of yourselves, okay? And sometimes these kids just, like, are so young, and I look at them, I'm like, why are you asking such hard questions? Like, really don't, like, even if you have the answer to, really isn't going to make much of an impact. And today, I feel like we are sometimes like those second or third graders that sometimes will just ask these really obscure questions, or, like, we'll just be fine, we'll just be walking along, and then we'll be like, oh my gosh, like, and then you just, like, freak out about, like, and then don't know what your future holds and all these things. And sometimes I just feel like God looks down on us and says, like, hey, you're asking the wrong things. You're worried about the wrong things. And so today we're going to try to tackle some questions that I think many of us have either asked, been asked, or are going to ask. And so I put these questions up on a slide for us. And all of us have asked, or at one point going to be asked, why do good things happen to bad people? Why do bad things happen to good people? Overall, what's the point in being good? Right? So, like, if bad people get away with some things, and I'm over here, like, following all the rules, like, then, and why do I have to be good if other people are getting away with all of this? And those that are getting away with it, why does God allow that to happen? And so we find ourselves in a place where we begin to question God's goodness. We begin to question why he's allowing some things to happen. And we begin to envy the wicked, right? That's what Solomon is going to tell us today. And so I'm going to try to break down these things. I'm going to try to address, one, the answer to this, but before that, I'm going to try to address why some of us are even asking these questions. But before we jump into these verses, I wanted to define a couple things for us, okay? Because Solomon uses some words that I think many of us have heard. I think many of us use, like, they're not hard words. But I think Solomon might define them differently than we do. Like, if I ask you guys, hey, what makes a person good? Some of you guys might be like, oh, well, like, someone that lets me cheat off their homework. Like, that's a good person. Like, that's a homie, right? And then I'd be like, well, what's a bad person? What makes a person bad? And be like, well, they don't let me cheat off their homework. Like, what? Like, that's not a good friend. And Solomon is talking about something different. Why? Because he's holding people to a much higher standard than some of us might be holding them when we try to define what makes someone good or bad. And so what Solomon says is a good or righteous person, Solomon says that it's someone that fears the Lord, or that has the fear of God. And so, contrary to that, Solomon says, well, the person that's bad or someone that's wicked is someone that does not fear God. Okay? And then you guys look at me like, okay, well, then what's the fear of God? Like, everyone say, ooh. Like, sometimes we hear of these, like, theological, like, biblical phrases, and we're just like, yeah, I know what that means. But in reality, like, sometimes we just kind of, like, hope that eventually it's going to come, like, we're going to understand what it is. So no worries. Today we're going to define what fear of God means. What it doesn't mean is, it doesn't mean that whenever you think of God, you're like, that doesn't mean that you're terrified of God. That's not what fear of God means. Simply put, fear of God is holding God to the utmost respect, honor, and awe. okay? I found a quote that I really like from a pastor that I listened to. His name is Timothy Keller. And it's a pretty long passage, so I'm just going to take out little bits and pieces of it. And he says, obviously, to be in the fear of the Lord is not to be scared of the Lord. It's not that obvious to some of us. So he says, fear in the Bible means to be overwhelmed, to be controlled by something. To fear the Lord is to be overwhelmed with wonder before the greatness of God and his love. Fearing him means bowing before him out of amazement at his glory and beauty. So basically, when we're talking about what makes a person good, righteous, it means that it's someone that is just an amazement to God. That when God speaks or when God tells us to do something, we honor that above any other commands, above any other thing that's here on earth. And so Solomon, in these next few verses, is going to talk about the good and the bad. And I just want us to understand that when he calls people good, it's people that are fearing God. Whereas the people that aren't good or are wicked are people that do not hold God to a high esteem, that ignore God, that do their own, whatever they want to do. All right? So with all that being said, I feel like we have a better grasp of some of these words. So let's jump in to these verses. So we're starting at Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 9, and we're going to go through 13. And so he says, I have thought deeply about all that goes on here under the sun, where people have the power to hurt each other. I have seen wicked people buried with honor, yet they were the very ones who frequented the temple and are now praised in the same city where they committed their crimes. This too is meaningless. When a crime is not punished quickly, people feel it is safe to do wrong, but even though a person sins 100 times and still lives a long time, I know that those who fear God will be better off. The wicked will not prosper, for they do not fear God. Their days will never grow long like the evening shadows. All right, so right there, Solomon just dropped like a bunch of verses on us, a bunch of truth bombs. And so I want to jump back into verse 9, and I want to pick some of these things apart for us to really understand where Solomon's coming from. And so at the very beginning, we see that Solomon highlights something. Solomon is seeing what's going on in his city, and he's like, yo, this is whack, okay? There's something going on here. He says, there are people that are evil. There are people that are bad, and those people that are committing crimes in their own cities, those same people are being honored. And so at this point, Solomon's already highlighting the fact that, like, evil is sometimes honored, that people that are bad are sometimes praised. Who here has ever been watching a movie, right, and you're just sitting there, and then you identify the villain, and you're like, okay, that's a bad guy, okay. And then you keep watching, and they're like, wait, I kind of vibe with the bad guy. Like, right, like you begin to cheer the bad guy on. Like, has anyone ever been in that position where you're like, yeah, the bad guy is actually kind of dope. I'm switching teams right here. Like, the bad guy is my favorite character here. I know that there's, like, a lot of Marvel people here. Apparently, like, there's a huge fan base for, like, Loki. Like, apparently everyone's like, oh, I love him. But, like, he's, like, the bad guy, isn't he? Like, another thing is in Hollywood, there was, like, this time in Hollywood where a bunch of people, or a bunch of directors and a bunch of producers just decided for some reason for a few years to make these movies about robbing banks, right? That was like the whole plot. And for some reason, for like 4 years in Hollywood, all the movies were about like, hey, like you get your friends together and like they're going to rob a bank. And I remember like people watching this and be like, yo, dude, that's so cool. And like in reality, like robbing a bank is illegal. Like that's bad, right? But so many people thought it was so cool. Why? Because the people were honored, the people were glorified, the people were praised, the bad people were seen as the cool people. And I find it really interesting that if we jump to the very next verse, we see here that Solomon says that when a crime is not punished quickly, people feel it is safe to do wrong. And so I want to camp out there real quick, because I think that a lot of times the reason why some of us begin to question God, a lot of times when we begin to question, well, why can they do that and I can't? A lot of times when we begin to envy the wicked and we begin to question God is because we don't have the right mentality. And I think that's something that stuck out to me when I was reading this, that there are two mentalities that we need to distinguish. There are the people that are on this side, they're more concerned about getting in trouble. And then there are people on this side that their biggest concern, their biggest worry is, am I honoring God? And so let's break this down. Let's take these people. That their biggest concern is, I don't want to get in trouble. But then when they realize that
the threat of being in trouble is taken away. Like right here what Solomon is saying, when a crime is not quickly punished, people then begin to realize or begin to think, oh, well, maybe I can do it. An example that comes to my mind is, I remember when I was taking a test sometime in high school, our teacher walked out. I don't know why she did it. I don't know if she was trying to do like an honor policy thing. And I remember some of our friends just began to look at each other's pages and they began to help each other out. But our teacher had told us strictly to not do that. And so at that point, there were people that wouldn't have cheated. But once they realized that they were no longer going to get in trouble, once that the barrier, the only thing that was holding them back from doing something wrong was gone, they decided to do it. But in that moment, I had a decision. I was like, I know that I'm not going to get in trouble. I know that there's no consequence for me. But I know that that does not honor God. And so I think many times when we begin to question God, or many times when we begin to envy the wicked, it's because our greatest concern isn't, am I honoring God? It's, am I going to get in trouble? And so what I want us to focus and to ask here today is, what is your mindset? When you begin to look at when people are getting away with things, is the reason why you're questioning God more because you're just having a normal conversation with him? Or is it more because, like, I want to do that? Because if that is your mentality, then we need to refocus, we need to reprioritize, and we need to identify that my number one concern should be honoring God. It doesn't matter if I'm going to get in trouble or not. The only thing that matters to me is, am I honoring God? And so right here, Solomon emphasizes this. Solomon right here, he says, hey, this is the problem. I see that people are being praised. People are getting away with things. I see that some punishments don't go, some crimes don't go punished, and therefore people think they want to do it. But then he says this. He says, hey, but I know that the people that fear God, they're going to be better off. So he drops this like truth bomb. But then he goes on to the next verses. Verses 14 through 15. And it says, this is not all that is meaningless in our world. In this life, good people are often treated as though they were wicked, and wicked people are often treated as though they were good. This is so meaningless. I want to pause there. And so Solomon, right here, he addresses this problem. He tells us a bunch of things. He says, hey, but those who fear God are going to be better off. But then he brings back the question. He says, hey, but I haven't forgotten. Look, why do bad things happen to good people? Why do good things happen to bad people? He still has that question. And what I think some of us are sitting here today, when we heard that this is going to be the topic, we were expecting an answer or a very direct answer to this question. But Solomon is going to give us an answer. In fact, he already has given us the answer, but he's not going to give us one that we're all expecting or one that we want. And so he addresses this question, and you'd expect the very next thing he says is to give you an answer. And he kind of does. Look what he says next. He says in verse 15, so I recommend having fun because there is nothing better for people in this world than to eat, drink, and enjoy life. That way they will experience some happiness along with all the hard work God gives them under the sun. So right here Solomon saying, like, hey, why is this happening? And then the very next verse he says, like, hey, might as well have fun. Like, what? Like, what was like, that's not the answer I was expecting at all. Like, why is he saying this? And so right here, I want us all to pay attention. I don't want us to overthink this one. I think right here, Solomon is saying, hey, I understand that life is tough. Hey, I understand that there are these problems. Make the most of what you have. Now, he's not promoting a crazy lifestyle. I want that to be clear. What Solomon is saying is like, hey, I understand that there's this issue here. Hey, enjoy the life you've been given so you can enjoy it along with the work that God gives you. Now, here's the crazy thing to me, is that when you read this, he says that this is the most that life is going to give you. So there's those people right here that don't fear God, that this life is all they have. And so when they go out and they have fun and do all these crazy things, and you're thinking to yourself, why are they doing that? It's because that's the most that they're ever going to have. That's the best thing that they're ever going to be offered. That is the height of luxury for them. Whereas we know that we're going to be better off. But Solomon still has more to tell us. If we look at the very next verses, he tells us that in my search for wisdom, in my observation of people's burdens here on earth, I discovered that there is ceaseless activity day and night. I realized that no one can discover everything God is doing under the sun. Not even the wisest people discover everything. no matter what they claim. So Solomon, what's the answer? Why do good things happen to bad people? Solomon right here is saying, like, listen, I don't know. That's his answer to us. He's like, well, you're asking me these questions. Reality is, I don't know. And if anyone goes to claim that they know the answer, that's a lie. So right here we're saying, like, Solomon, you're the wisest person to ever live, and you don't know the answer to why do good things happen to bad people? And I want us to focus right here, because at this point, this is when we begin to act like those third graders. This is when God is saying, like, hey, you're asking the wrong things. You're focusing on the wrong thing. Because I want us all to jump back to verses 12 and 13. It says here, when Solomon says, even though a person sins 100 times and still lives a long time, I know that those who fear God will be better off. The wicked will not prosper, for they do not fear God. Their days will never grow long like the evening shadows. So, what's the answer to this, Solomon? Like, why do good things happen to bad people? Why do good people suffer? Solomon says, hey, I don't know. I know one thing, though. Those who fear God will be better off. So check it out. Solomon is saying, hey, I don't know the answer to that, but we shouldn't be concerned about that. That's not something we're meant to understand. We're meant to understand one thing, and that one thing is those who fear God. If you fear God, you're going to be better off. And so for us to better be able to understand this, I want to bring an example to you guys. So I'm going to call up Caleb. If you can help me out, if you can, right here, just grab this cord, and if you could just go all the way to that door back there. So go all the way. Right? So this is a long extension cord, okay? We're not sponsored by Home Depot, but right? So this is a super long extension cord. Okay, so he's at the back. Okay, I want it to be a little bit longer, okay? So we're going to connect it to this guy right here, okay? So even longer. Get out the door, man. Leave. Go. Okay? Yeah, everyone say bye to Caleb. So we're going. You can keep going, buddy. He's out the door. He's gone. Okay, so check it. Look, we don't know where Caleb's at. I want us all to picture this extension cord right here, this whole line, as eternity. Yeah, it's still moving, exactly. Like, it's still going, right? This whole extension cord right here is eternity. We can't see the end of it. That's what eternity is. I want us to picture this part right here, this black part right here. This represents our life. And so what Solomon is telling us is that, hey, in this life, the only thing we should be concerned about, the only question we should be asking is, do I fear God? If the answer is yes, hey, you're going to be better off. What Solomon is saying, hey, right now, all of us that are questioning God, all of us that are envying the evil, all of us that have these questions and it's taking up our mind of why does he get to do that? Why does she get to do that? Why can't I do this? That's not what we're supposed to be doing in this lifetime. That's not our greatest concern. Solomon's saying, hey, you're asking the wrong questions. The one thing you should be asking, the one thing you should be concerned about is, hey, do I fear God? Am I honoring God? If the question is yes, hey, I'm going to be better off. And I know that some of us may not be completely satisfied with that answer. But that's the reality of it. That some of us are just too concerned about the wrong things. And Solomon is calling us to attention that, hey, the only thing that matters is not why do bad people prosper, why do good people suffer. Our only question, our only concern about this life is, do I honor God? What I want to do next is I want to read a psalm for us, okay? And so this psalm is going to be a little bit long. I recognize that. But it's a psalm that we see in the Bible of someone asking a really similar question to this. Because what I don't want is for you guys to leave today and think to yourselves, like, man, I've been asking this question. Like, it's not a problem if you guys ask this question. It's dangerous, though, if we just stay there. And so what we're going to see in this psalm is someone who has this question, someone that's dedicated their life to God, and yet they begin to ask these things. And so we're going to go to Psalm 73. And this is a psalm by Asaph. And Asaph was a worship leader. And so at this point, we're seeing someone that's a worship leader that's dedicating their entire life to honoring and worshiping God. And this is what he has to say. He says, "Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost slipped. I had nearly lost my foothold, for I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. They have no struggles. Their bodies are healthy and strong. They are free from common human burdens. They are not plagued by human ills. Therefore, pride is their necklace. They clothe themselves with violence. From their callous hearts comes iniquity. Their evil imagination has no limits. They scoff and speak with malice. Their arrogance, they threaten oppression. Their mouths lay claim to heaven, and their tongues take possessions of the earth. Therefore, their people turn to them and drink up waters in abundance. They say, 'How would God know? Does the Most High know anything?' This is what the wicked are like, always free of care, and they go on amassing wealth." And then he says, "Surely in vain I have kept my heart pure and have washed my hands in innocence. All day long I have been afflicted, and every morning brings new punishments. If I had spoken out like that, I would have been betrayed your children. When I tried to understand all this, it troubled me deeply." And then he says, "But then I entered the sanctuary of God. Then I understood their final destiny. Surely you placed them on a slippery ground. You cast them down to ruin. How suddenly are they destroyed, completely swept away by terrors. They are like a dream when one awakes when you arise, Lord. You will despise them as fantasies. When my heart was grieved and my spirit embittered, I was senseless and ignorant. I was a brute beast before you. Yet I am always with you. You hold me by my right hand. You guide me with your counsel. And afterward, you will take me into glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? Earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Those who are far from you will perish. You destroy all who are unfaithful to you. But as for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the sovereign Lord my refuge. I will tell of all your deeds." And so what's Asaph saying? What's Solomon saying? What is the point of tonight? Is that during this lifetime, our minds should not be focused on what's happening to the bad. Our minds should not be focused on who's prospering, on who's suffering. Our hearts should go out and expand the kingdom and be there for people. But when it comes to us, we should not be envying the wicked. The one thing that we need to recognize here on earth for our lifetime, which to us may seem long, but in reality it isn't. The one responsibility that we have, the one thing that our minds should 100% be on, the question we should be asking is, do I fear God? And if the answer is yes, we know that we're going to be better off. And so here, tonight, I want to ask that question. Is, do you fear God? Or are you envying other things? Is your mind set more on the things of the world and looking after that than the things of the kingdom? Because here, Solomon in his wisdom is telling us, if the answer is any different than yes, I fear God, then we're focusing on the wrong things. So I want to invite you guys to close your eyes and bow your heads. And when I want to ask the first group of people is those of you that right now feel that, hey, I've got to be envying the world. I've been envying the wicked, and I recognize that I need to shift my mindset, that I need to refocus, and that I need to begin to fear God and pursue Him. If that's you, I invite you to raise your hand. I see your hand. Okay, let's pray. Father, we welcome you tonight, Father. We thank you, Father, for the word that you help prepare, Father, the word that you had, Father. We thank you, God, for the hearts that you've touched, God. We thank you for the opportunity, God, to be able to hear and understand, God, that our one focus here on earth, God, the one thing that we should be concerned about, God, is honoring you. So Father, tonight I just pray, God, that you completely take control of these young minds, that you completely take control of these students that are willing to lay things down at your feet, those that are willing and recognizing that they've been envying the world, that they've been envying the wicked. Father, I pray that tonight, God, they'd be able to let go of those desires, that they'd be let go of that envy, Father. And the only thing that they desire tonight, Father, would be a relationship with you, Father. A new desire to just begin to pursue you, Lord. Father, tonight, Father, I pray that new fires will be lit. Father, that a new passion, God, for you will be stirred in this room. Come, Holy Spirit, and begin to move in each and every single one of our lives, God, that we begin to question our actions, that we begin to question our motives, God, if they do not honor you. Father, if we've been questioning you, God, if we've been questioning your goodness, if we've been despising some of the things that we think are from you, Father, we just lay that down at our feet, Father. We say, and we apologize, and at this moment we say, less of me, more of you. Father, you come and take control of our hearts, our desires, our minds. Father, that right now, we begin to ask, do I fear God? And that, Father, after tonight, we be able to answer, yes. Father, we thank you, God, that our life, that our luxury, that our pleasure, Father, is not just defined by the next 70, 80 years here on earth, but that you have something much better, a greater reward for us in eternity. And so, Father, allow us to be stirred to share the word to others so that they too can bask in that eternal glory. We thank you for what you've done. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for this word. And Lord, we throw all things aside and just pursue you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, guys. Thank you so much for letting me come up here. I forgot who's going to be coming up after this. We're moving into worship now. So we're going to move on to another part of worship, guys. So you can come on up. Careful with the cable. Careful with eternity. Don't trip up on it. And yeah.